SpaceX's Starlink division is on track to offer satellite broadband service in the United States in mid-2020. The company president and chief operating officer, Gwynne Shotwell, said October 22nd. Getting there will require the company to launch 6 to 8 batches of satellites, Shotwell told reporters during a media roundtable. SpaceX also has to finish the design and engineering of the user terminals, which is not a minor challenge, Shotwell acknowledged. SpaceX's proposed Starlink constellation of thousands of satellites, which are designed to orbit at low altitudes above the Earth and beam internet coverage to the surface below. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk posted 2 tweets that show he's testing the broadband service. Elon Musk has a Starlink terminal at his house, and he used it to send a tweet early on October 22nd. Sending this tweet through space via Starlink satellite, Elon Musk tweeted to his 29 million followers. 2 minutes later, Musk sent a follow-up tweet that said, "Whoa, it worked!" In this video, Engineering Today will discuss SpaceX's plan to provide internet coverage with Starlink constellation as soon as mid-2020. Let's get started. Mid-2020 is slightly more specific than the timing provided in previous SpaceX statements, but we already knew Starlink service was projected to arrive sometime in 2020. SpaceX previously said it plans to deploy satellite broadband in the northern United States and Canada as soon as next year. Shotwell said SpaceX will need to complete 6 to 8 Starlink launches, including the one that already took place in May, to ensure continuous service in upper and lower latitude bands. "We need 24 launches to get global coverage," she said. "Every launch after that gives you more capacity." SpaceX launched 60 satellites in May this year to test the system before preparing for a wider deployment. SpaceX has so far secured licensing from the Federal Communications Commission to launch nearly 12,000 satellites into orbit and is seeking permission to launch as many as 30,000 more. The company caused a stir last week when it submitted another request to an international regulator, the International Telecommunications Union, ITU, asking for radio frequencies to communicate with an additional 30,000 SpaceX Starlink satellites. That means the company wants the ability to launch an estimated 42,000 satellites into orbit to build the world's largest low-Earth orbit broadband constellation. As demand escalates for fast, reliable internet around the world, especially for those where connectivity is non-existent, too expensive, or unreliable, SpaceX is taking steps to responsibly scale Starlink's total network capacity and data density to meet the growth in users' anticipated needs, a SpaceX spokesperson said in a statement in reference to the new ITU filing. But Shotwell and SpaceX are not certain that it will need that many satellites. Far fewer are needed for global coverage, but the company wants extra spacecraft to be able to offer customers customized service options. SpaceX Starlink is a meshed network of satellites connected to each other by space lasers. "We'll continue to upgrade the network until mid to late next year," said Shotwell. "We're hoping for 24 launches by the end of next year." SpaceX wants to offer Starlink both to home internet users and the U.S. government. Shotwell said many of the Starlink features are being tested by the U.S. Air Force Research Laboratory under a program called Global Lightning. SpaceX, in December 2018, received a $28 million contract to test over the next 3 years different ways in which the military might use Starlink broadband services. So far, SpaceX has demonstrated data throughout of 610 megabits per second in flight to the cockpit of a U.S. military C-12 twin-engine turboprop aircraft. SpaceX wants to offer the service to the U.S. government, but is now focused on how it will serve the consumer market. "Many of the details on how the service will be rolled out remain to be worked out," she said. "When possible, it will be offered directly to consumers following Musk's Tesla modeling for selling cars. It's possible the service will be offered directly to customers, while in some countries, the company will be required to partner with local telecom firms to offer the service. Customers will need to sign up for the service through a telecom service provider," according to Shotwell. She said Starlink is considered additive to our business, meaning that it will not replace space launch services as SpaceX's primary source of revenue. Selling directly to regular customers will be a new challenge for the company, requiring new sales, tech support, and product engineering staff. Shotwell acknowledged that this is very different business for SpaceX. She recognized a lot of this is uncharted territory for SpaceX, and she said, "It's leveraging space technology, but it's a consumer business." SpaceX will have to hire a whole new workforce to deal with sales, tech support, and product engineering. User terminals are a major concern. "The more engineering we do on the user terminal, the less service people will have to hire," said Shotwell. "Terminals are one aspect of the Starlink business that the company has to get right," she said. "When consumers sign up, they're going to receive a box from SpaceX with a user terminal and a cord," said Shotwell. "How that gets connected and where the terminal should be placed in someone's home? SpaceX is still ironing out the technology for user terminals." "We still have a lot to do to get that right," said Shotwell. Knowing Elon, he wants everything to be beautiful, so the user terminal will be beautiful. Once up and running, satellite internet can provide access to a much wider range of people than today's fiber and cable-based networks can. One of the only disadvantages for widespread use is latency. Satellite systems have a latency of 638 milliseconds, which is roughly 20 times slower than wired. Data can be downloaded on these high-latency networks at similar speeds to regular connections, but response time for gaming and other reactive-sensitive uses could be disappointing. While SpaceX has said it intends to provide gigabit speeds and latency as low as 25 milliseconds, a big unanswered question is how much it'll cost. SpaceX is apparently still trying to figure that out. The price point is also being studied. Shotwell said millions of people in the U.S. pay $80 per month to get crappy service. She didn't say whether SpaceX Starlink will cost more or less than $80 per month, but suggested that would be a segment of the public the company would target, as well as rural areas that currently have no connectivity. Outside the United States, SpaceX is working nation by nation to get authorization to offer the service. "Every country has its own process," said Shotwell. The terminals today are being produced at SpaceX's factory in Hawthorne, California, but mass manufacturing in the future will move to a different location. Shotwell declined to name. As more Starlink launches are planned, SpaceX wants to use previously flown Falcon boosters as much as possible, said Shotwell. "I think we'll manage the fleet how best we manage the fleet," she said. "Our intent is to use Starlink to push the capability of those boosters and see how many missions they can do." A single Falcon booster was designed for 10 flights. The next SpaceX Starlink mission, scheduled in mid-November, will be launched by a booster on its fourth flight. Since SpaceX started returning boosters in 2015, 44 first stages were recovered, 26 at sea and 18 on land. So far, 23 of the recovered boosters have flown. SpaceX is racing to get Starlink in operation as several other companies continue to build competing broadband constellations. Shotwell said there's probably room in the market for at least two competitors. "If we do well and make money, there will be competitors." Satellite internet firm OneWeb and satellite operator Kepler Communications have work underway on their own constellations and have also filed against Starlink, claiming that it would cause signal interference at the lower elevation and potentially even pose a collision risk. When the FCC approved the project, it found that the modification proposed by SpaceX does not present significant interference problems and is in the public interest. That's promising. Beaming down internet from satellites sounds like a terrific idea with lots of perks, but numerous other companies have run into problems with similar projects. Facebook's Project Athena, after failing to get its drones to work properly, turned to satellites with the aim of launching an internet constellation by early 2019, which the company hasn't yet. Similarly, Google is working on Project Loon, which aims to provide 4G internet (LTE) to remote regions of the world using hot air balloons. It too has run into numerous obstacles, a major patent lawsuit among them. Amazon too has also announced Project Kuiper, its own project for satellite internet services. There's reason for SpaceX to hurry. If SpaceX takes too long, it risks losing customers to rivals that would be more than happy to fill the gap. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.